Hello, everybody. I'm Joe Fuco from GoDpsMusic, and we have an incredible night of music for you tonight. We would like to thank LP for sponsoring tonight's event, and we are just about ready to get started. It's my extreme pleasure to introduce to you tonight Ron Powell. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming to our whatever this is. I would also like to thank Latin Percussion for inviting us here, and Joe, and GoDpsMusic. What we're doing tonight is we're taking a rhythmic journey with our percussion instruments, an Afrocentric journey. We're gonna begin in Africa, and then we're gonna go to the Americas, or we'll probably go to Caribbean America, and Central America, then we'll go to North America, then we'll end up in South America. Okay? Yeah, something like that. We're gonna cover a lot of stuff. Hopefully, it will be entertaining for you and informative. But I'd like to say that the thing that we do probably the best, and we all work with a lot of people and we have for decades, but the thing that we do the best, we won't be able to do for you tonight. Okay, so it's true. The thing that we do the best is, well, we've learned our instruments, we've learned how to be diverse on our instruments, we've learned a lot of different rhythms, and the thing that we do the best is we go and play with other artists and make their music sound the way they want their music to sound, okay? What I mean by that is like, when I work with Sergio Mendes, he wants me to sound Brazilian. So I've studied my craft so that I can do that. And then when I play with Santana or play with El Chicano or Bobby Redsfield, Latin jazz band, they want me to sound like I'm from East LA. And so then I put that hat on. And then when I go and play with Madonna, then she wants pop rock, and I turn into that guy. And then when I used to play with Barry White, and all of a sudden now I'm an R&B guy. Okay, so like in relationship to drum set, everybody can play 2 and 4, but there are a lot of different ways to play it. You could play it a little bit ahead of the beat, or you can play behind the beat. You could swing it a little bit, or you can play it very straight. And you have to be able to read the artist that you're playing with and give them what they want, make them feel like you're representing what's in their head, their music. And that's the really difficult thing about being a professional musician is giving the artists what they want so that the music sounds good. And so we can't do that because all those artists aren't here. Okay, so, but what we are gonna do tonight is we're gonna take that rhythmic journey, and let's get started. Oh, let me start by also introducing my friends, Nat Scott on drums. Where'd he go? Oh. Luis Silvestri on percussion. Quinn Johnson on keys. I'm Ron Powell. Okay.
Africa is the root.
Yeah.
Africa is the root. Igaba. Thank you.
All right. 1, 2. Are you guys getting the mic in there? Yes? Okay, cool. All right, part one. So our journey there began in Africa with the bata drum and praising Eleguai Shango. And then we played the djembe drum, and that's this drum right here. It's a hollow cylinder. It has a goatskin stretched across the front, and the string is tied around it to tighten the skin. And that's the djembe. Sounds like this. And then we also play the chekere, which is a musical instrument invented by a woman. It's a gourd. It's like a squash that grows out of the ground, and it has a top one here. So we cut the top off, hollowed it out, took all the seeds and stuff out, and then let it sit in the sun for about a month or so, and that makes the shell hard. And then we put a skirt of beads around it, and turned it into a musical instrument. So this is the chekere. That's the chekere. And normally, when you have the djembe, the ensemble is usually two or three djembes and the djun-djun drums, which are like tom-toms, but like big. And each djun-djun usually has a piece of metal or a bell attached to it. And one player will play the bell with one hand and the head with a stick. And Nat is playing, you know, I've got two hands, but I'm covering this, but he's got like four limbs there. And so he's covering like all three djun-djun parts and all the bell parts and the chekere part and one of the djembe parts in the last pattern that we were playing. Let's play a Yankadi pattern. Okay, you remember that one?
Yeah.
You with me? Okay. So I got this drum. You get the three djembes and the bell and one of the djembe parts, okay? Chose the instrument. Okay. On that subject, how many musicians are here tonight? Okay. Anybody, like, any serious musicians here? Okay. I just bring that up because often people ask me about being a working musician. Okay, and usually when someone asks me that question, my reply usually is, "Well, are you serious about it?" And then I start going through all these questions, and my first question then is like, "Okay, well, how many hours a week do you put into your being a musician?" You know, like a lot of kids don't want to practice, and even a lot of guys, you know, that are grown and you know, think they know their instrument, still don't want to practice, but then they're upset because they're like, how come that guy got the gig? And how come I didn't get the call? Okay. It's no big secret. You have to treat playing music like it's a career and not like it's a hobby. Okay. I ask people all the time, do you put in 40 hours a week at your craft, especially conga players? Okay, do you put in 40 hours a week? You know, which you can break it up any way you want, but a good way to break it up would be, say, 30 hours of practice, which is, you know, 5 hours a day, every day, okay, 6 days a week, and then 10 hours of networking, because that's a big part of this business, just, you know, meeting that guy and meeting his friends and meeting his friends and making sure that they like you so that they call you for their gigs and so on and so on. So 10 hours of networking and 30 hours of practice. Usually when I ask somebody if they do that, they go, well, no, I did practice on Monday for... Okay, but that's just the beginning. So to be a serious working musician, you have to put in the time, just like you would if you worked at McDonald's, and if you worked 30 hours. They'd call that part-time. Okay, it's just kind of like a hobby, you know. If you're selling shoes or stocks or whatever, you got to put in 40 hours, and if you really want to get good at it, you're going to put in 60 hours a week, okay, and not just one, well, not just 1 week, but like for the rest of your life. But if you love playing, then it's more with any career. If you love what you're doing, it's not really a job. It's about your career, and it's about, you know, making your thing better. Okay, so if you want to be serious at it, if you want to get any kind of work at it, then put in the time, do the homework, do the practicing, and eventually something will happen. Okay, today we're doing our rhythmic journey. We're focusing on drums from all over, you know, a lot of different places. We're adding the keyboard so that our drum music, like, we're used to just hearing drums, and to us that's fine, that's enough, you know. But for most people, they want to hear harmony and melody and all that kind of stuff. So that's why Quinn is here, you know, to make the music seem a little bit more familiar. But so with the drums, and we have to learn like rhythms and grooves and phrasing, all that kind of stuff. So just for everybody out there, let's just run through a couple of different grooves. Just a couple of different grooves, and we'll see where this goes. Let's start off with a calypso groove. Cool? Yeah. Okay. And if anybody, we know every groove in the world, so if anybody has a groove they want to hear, just nobody cares. No, which actually is an important thing. No one knows everything. We're constantly learning. I've been playing for 40 years, and I still take lessons, I still study, I go all over the world, and I look for the cats that play their thing in Mozambique and in Recife. And, you know, so I travel the world to try to find out, why do guys play the way they do? Okay, so this is like a never-ending thing. So nobody knows everything. So we'll throw that disclaimer out there right now. Okay, so let's hit this calypso groove. All right, count it off. Okay, the conga drums, are actually the tumbadoras, are they came from Africa, from the Makuta or the Ngoma drum, but they developed into the tumbadoras, the drums that we know now, in Cuba. And one of the rhythms from Cuba is bolero. And so let's touch on that for just a second. Okay, so bolero would be like a ballad. So you got something to play on that? Okay. Bongo. Thank you. that. Pretty. Okay. Let's.
No, not that one.
Okay, I'll tell you what. At the noche. See? Okay. Hopefully that'll help. We gotta do the break. Not yet. I'll let you know when I need that. You ready?
mi tristeza se fue. Doce sueños en mi vida, cae la lluvia, sale el sol. Lo que quiero, doce sueños, es el ritmo del amor. Esta noche, si me muero, yo me muero bailando. Esta noche, si me muero, yo me muero bailando. Esta noche, si me muero, yo me muero bailando. Esta noche, si me muero, yo me muero bailando. Esta noche.
Okay, before I go any further, since we're obviously in the Caribbean, there's a very important thing that I have to talk about, and that's a thing called clave. Anybody heard of clave before? Okay, so in Latin music and Afrocentric Latin music, clave is extremely important. And so I'll run through it, but if you're going to play any kind of Latin music, check it out. Okay. So clave. Clave is four things. The first thing clave is, it's an instrument, two sticks. And these are the two sticks. Now, sometimes you could substitute the instrument for something else. So that sound can be produced, say, as a rim shot. Okay, but or you might have the clave on the foot. But you could even play the clave on the hi-hat. Okay. Or if I play it on the side of the drum. I'm still playing the instrument clave. Okay, but this is the actual instrument. Now, in dealing with Afrocentric music, we're dealing with a lot of different languages. Many dialects of African languages, and also with Spanish, and also with English. And so, often we have overlapping phrases and five words for the same thing. Like, so say for example, these are tumbadoras, but they are all known as congas. And there's three different sizes. I like to play four, but there's three different sizes. The highest and the highest tuned one and the smallest head is called the quinto. And the drum in the middle, because it's the middle size, is called the conga. And then the largest drum is called the tumba. Now, the tumba plays the tumbao, which is the bottom. But sometimes you play the bottom on the quinto, which is the high drum. And then the conga, being the second drum, usually plays the second part out of the three parts. But if you only have two drums, then you play the conga on the quinto. So anyway, so it could get a little bit confusing, but you know, if you get into it, then it starts getting clear. Okay, now back to clave. So clave is four things. One, it's an instrument. Two, it's a rhythm pattern, and that rhythm pattern sounds like this. One, two. Can you clap along? Shaving my haircut, two bits. Okay. Okay, so that rhythm pattern, it's a two-bar phrase and it has five hits. And it's in 4-4, and those hits fall on one, the and of two, on four, and also in the next bar on two and three. So it's one, two, and three, four, one, two, three, four. One, two, and three, four, one, two, three, four. Okay, that clave is called son clave. Son is a style of music. Now that clave, because it's two bars, can begin on either bar, because it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. You have two ones, so you get to pick which one you start on. Okay, so if you start in the bar with the bar that has three hits, I'll try to keep it short, I promise. if you play the bar that has three hits first and the bar that has two hits second, then it's referred to as forward clave. If you play the bar with the two hits in it first, then it's reverse clave. Okay, so here's 3-2 clave. 1, 2, and 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now here's 2-3 clave. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, and 3, 4. Okay, so that's two ways of playing clave. There are two other ways of playing clave. That's son clave. There's also a clave called rumba clave, which is used for rumba rhythm patterns. Patterns like rumba colombia, yambu, and guaguancó. The difference between the two claves is the bar that has three hits, the second hit, the third hit, is on the and of four, as opposed to being on four. 1, 2, and 3, 4, and 1. 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, and 3, 4, and 1. 2, 3, 4. So that's 3-2. Now we can also play that 2-3. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, and 3, 4, and 1. 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, and 3, 4, and 1. 2, 3, 4. Okay. 90% of the time, those are the four claves that you're going to use in Afrocentric music. Occasionally, you're going to play it in 6-8, and then also you're going to have a three side and a two side, and so that kind of brings you up to six different ways you can play the one clave pattern. Okay, clave is four things: an instrument, two, it's a rhythm pattern, three, clave has a function. And it's usually like it goes for all of the music, but usually in the drum situation, if we all had a drum, if we're all in the room and I want us to, like, everybody's kind of like making noise, and I want to get everybody's attention and kind of like call, hey, I'm throwing out a call, we're going to start playing. So I throw clave, and usually your response would be to play clave, and then we start our rhythm. And then while we're all playing, if I need to answer my phone, I'm going to stop. I throw clave, everybody throws clave, answers clave in response, and then we end. Okay, so clave has a function of calling response and also throwing out signals. All right, so that's the third thing clave is. The fourth thing that clave is that if you get it in a circle of Latin players, it's bound to break into an argument where the clave is in a song. And it's because of the fourth thing that clave is. Clave is a concept. It's a concept of, gosh, you hear it said a lot of different ways. Some people say clave means the key to Latin music. La llave, I mean, literally, clave is the key. Okay, but some people refer to clave as the heartbeat, or the pulse of Latin music. The way that I like to define clave is the one pattern that doesn't change that all other rhythm patterns are built upon. And that way, no matter where you are or who you're playing with, if you know how your pattern fits in clave, then you will always play it the same way. Okay? And let me give you an example of that. Okay, let's say I'm in a room and I have another good conga player with me, and he's from China. I'm not picking on Chinese people, but you know, let's just say he's from China. And then let's say I got a guy from Cuba, and I look at each guy to go, you know how to play congas? They both, yeah, I play congas, okay. And I say, okay, do you know a pattern 1-1-go? They both go, yeah, of course, you know. So I say to the Chinese guy, okay, you play 1-1-go. And he goes, 1, 2, 3, 1. To do that. Okay, minus the clave. But anyway, and then I look at the Cuban guy and I say, okay, can you play 1-1-go? He goes, yeah, of course. 1, 2, 3. Oh. Okay, I'm gonna do it one more time. And I should switch it because he's Cuban. All right, the Cuban guy, I say, can you play 1-1-go? He goes, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. And I say to the Chinese guy, play 1-1-go. He goes, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. Anybody? Anybody hear the difference? What was it?
It was different.
Okay, but what was different? Anybody hear it?
Yeah, the right touch goes fast from
the second one. Say it louder.
The right touch goes fast from the second one. Instead of it, I heard it. You hit it. How do I say it?
Three tunes.
You're close. Yeah, well, yes, but what gave it away?
The boss?
I heard that drum more often than I heard.
No, you were on the right track at first. Okay, I'll tell you what happened. It's where they began. They both played it exactly the same, but they started in different places. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One. Okay, then the other guy. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, okay? So if those two guys were playing together, the pattern would sound like this. Because they're both playing those two hits, those higher hits, opposite each other, okay? But they need to be in the same place so that it comes out as opposed to, okay? So those hits need to line up, so it depends, so they have to start in the same place. Okay, so when you know how your pattern fits with clave, you know where it starts. Okay, so you know to either start with the open tones or start with the slap. Okay, and so that happens with all the Latin patterns. They fit in clave a certain way, and if you're playing in China or if you're playing in Cuba or Brazil or Finland, if you know how your part fits with clave, then it will always be played the same way. Okay, so that's my definition of clave. I'll leave it at that because we could go on for an hour with clave, but I'll leave it at that. Let's see, very quickly on the congas, like I said, there are three different congas, the highest one being the quinto, conga being the middle, tumba being on the bottom. I just like to have an extra one on the bottom. Each drum has three basic sounds. It has an open tone, which you achieve by using this part of your hand up, hitting on the outer edge of the drum. And then there's a bass tone when you use all of this in the middle of the drum. And you'll get a better bass tone on a lower drum. Even like it. Okay, so you have an open tone, a bass tone, and you also have a slap. It's the hardest sound to get on the conga, but practice it and you'll get it. Imagine a circle in the middle of the drum. You're going to take your hand and cup it in a C position and hit the drum just inside of the circle. Now, if I hit outside of the circle, I'm going to get that open tone. But if I hit in the circle, it's going to be the slap. And let's see. Just like on this stick, when it has this cutout, and when I hit it like this, it has very little sound. But when I create a sound chamber here by cupping my hand under it, it produces a nice tone. And that's what happens here when you do this slap. You create a sound chamber, and it creates that slap sound. Okay, so there are three basic sounds on the conga, but there are 20, 25 variations on those three different sounds. So what I mean by that is, if the drum is on the ground, that's the open tone. If the drum is off the ground, the tone changes. Or you can change the pitch by applying pressure. Some guys use their head or their feet, okay? And then you can mute the tone. That's open, this is muted, okay? An open slap, a muted slap. Or you can mute it with the other hand. You can do a roll with your fingers. You can get a harmonic. A push tone. That was good. You can get combinations. You can do like flams. You can do an open tone and a slap together. So like I said, you can get like about 20 different variations. So if I have three congas, 20 sounds each drum, 60 to 40 sounds that I have with just four congas here, okay? So it can be a complicated thing. Now let's get back to some rhythm patterns. So the conga drum, even though it was originated in Africa and developed in Cuba, It's all over the world now. You go to China and guys are playing congas all over the place. And I play with other. I've done a lot of gigs like with the Boston Pops and a lot of different symphonies, LA and LA Philharmonic and the San Diego Symphony. And even all the guys, orchestral guys, are all playing congas now. And in R&B in the United States, guys are playing congas, and everybody doesn't play with a Latin feel. One of the most popular percussionists in the world is a guy by the name of Paulinho da Costa, and he's from Brazil, and he played on all the Lionel Richie, Michael Jackson stuff, and so all those conga parts that you heard, that's a Brazilian guy, you know. So a lot of people think that it's just a Latin thing, but it isn't anymore. It's all over the world. And so in R&B music, we hear congas a whole lot in the Ohio Players and Bootsy and all those guys. They all use conga drums. And let's play a straight 2-4 groove. And let's make it real basic. Now, when a percussionist and a drummer play together, often the percussionist thinks that he's drummer number two. Which is not, okay. He's the percussionist, that guy's the drummer. We each have a part to play. When we should play together, a lot of guys often will just play at the same time. Okay, he's doing his thing and he's doing his thing and, you know, never the two will meet. But it's supposed to be playing together. So let's give an example of even though we've been doing it all night, but an example of playing together. Let's play a 2-4 groove. Let's play it very basic. Do a fill, and then after the fill, I'll change the dynamic of it. I'll make it I'll take it up a little bit. Then you take it up a little bit. Then I'll take it up a little bit, and then you take it up a little bit. And let's see how high we can get this groove, and then we'll break it back down to the basic thing. Okay, 2-4. You got that? Okay. Phil. An example of working together, building the music. Like you could use one of those grooves on a verse section of a song, and then you take it up for the chorus, and then it could get even more exciting for like a double chorus out on a tune. Yeah. Okay. All right. Let's do a couple more grooves. Let's do a cha-cha. There's some maracas in here. Let's do a cha-cha, then take it up to a mambo, break it down, back to a cha-cha, and then take it to a songo. 2-3 clave all the way through. Okay, Quinn? Sure. I'm just saying. Okay? What do you? Cha-cha. A stick. A weedle stick. No? Mm-hmm.
Jimmy Clave Mambo. Vaya. Okay, so let's see. We were in Africa, we went to the Caribbean, we went up to North America, then we went back to the Caribbean. Let's go back to North America. Come out here for a minute. There's a drum
Probably the most popular drum in the world is the djembe. Okay, I've seen this all over the place. And actually, I go to China a lot. And in China, they actually think that this is a Chinese drum. Okay, you know, but it's West African. Okay, but there's a drum that's gaining a lot of popularity around the world, and it's a drum that's called what's that thing down there that looks like a box? Can you hold that? Can you hold that up? The thing that looks like a box, it's called box. but it's in Spanish, cajon. Okay, so it's a box, and it's actually, that's enough. You can sit in Vanna, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, Vanna White. Okay, right. Oh. Okay, all right, hold on. So the cajon is actually used in Peru. And they have there's a group of Palo Africans and you know it's a great Peruvian rhythmic band and they play cajon in all their songs, and they have a lot of very great patterns, and they're all set patterns, and there are right ways to play the drum, okay, for Peruvian style drumming. Now a few decades ago, a Brazilian guy moved to Peru and fell in love with Peruvian music, and he hung out there for a couple years. And then he moved from Peru to Spain, and he took a cajon with him and introduced the cajon to Spain. And now in Spanish music, the cajon is one of the most important instruments in their music. So you get the guitar, and you get the castanets, and now cajon. And that's how the cajon got to Spain. Now in Spain, there are also specific patterns to play, bolaria and rumba flamenco. So a lot of very specific patterns that are played. And then also on the cajon, in Cuba, they'll take the patterns that they play on the tumbadoras and also apply that to the cajon. And then again, you have very specific patterns to play. Having said that, one of the reasons why this drum is so popular around the world right now is because it can sound like a drum set. Okay, you can get a bass and you can get a high tone, and a lot of guys just don't want to carry all that stuff because it took him hours to set up, but we won't get into that. it takes a long time to set up all that stuff, and the cajon, you could just walk in, sit down on it, and start playing. And so a lot of guys, especially like if you're playing in a coffee house or something like that, and like a guitar or just a piano, the cajon is a great instrument for that because you can make it sound like a drum set. So Nat, being our drummer, is going to play some type of drum set pattern on the cajon. Okay? Put it like in the brown here. Now, like I said, it's a box. And so a lot of guys will try to tell you that there's, you have to play with this certain technique and don't do this and do that. It's a box. Okay, hit the thing and find the tones that, if you're playing it in this style, find the tones that work well for you. Now, this isn't the ethnic traditional setting, but for this purpose, what you want to do is fine. But you know, this is kind of like, I'm actually from Philadelphia, even though I live in California, and this is kind of reminding me of like my East Coast vibe. I can't help myself, I gotta do it. You see, I remember the time when I was just a kid. Was someone like the others, I was hanging at the crib. Well, the weather, my life was about to change. The path I would take would never be the same. You see, my uncle came by and asked my mom if we could watch his stuff along with his drum. Agreed we did, and then he waved goodbye. He was gone from our lives for a very long time, so we kept his drum every day. Through blood, sweat, and passion, I ignored the pain. As sane as it seemed, I wanted to be like the best, because sooner than later, I'd be put to the test. I said, doom, doom, bop, doom, doom, da, doom, bop, doom, doom. Now I'm hell, but most is one of the best in the world. You see, that's the way my life unfurls. See, I tell you the truth, and it ain't no lie. In the jungle, the drum was the way to survive. I said, hey, como fue? Que es bala con la música? I said, hey, escúchame. Que es bala con la música? I said, hey, como fue? Que es bala con la música? I said, hey. I had to go there. Now, to me, I feel like I'm just getting started. But for you guys, this might be getting along, but we're like halfway through.
I'm not even.
And I think we're going to have some questioning. So if you have any questions about anything that we've played so far, and believe it, we have a whole lot more. But if you have any questions about what we've done so far, now's the time.
We do have a few online that we have to ask right here for you. So Matthew Smith said, what microphone setup do you use for various percussion and the type and position?
Ooh, okay. I played a lot of different bands in a lot of different situations. From, let's say, like a coffee house where I'm using a cajon and there's like just a guitar player, or let's say being out on tour with Kenny G or Madonna, where I'm using a huge rig with four Compass djembes, two electronic setups, about 10 cymbals, a gigantic gong, and two or three percussion tables. So I go from using no mics and playing loud to having 18 mics. Miking the congas is totally different than miking ambient stuff like wind chimes or a triangle. And for the most part, I kind of leave that alone. Luckily for me, most of the bands, in all the bands that I play with, there's a sound man. And I kind of like let them do their job and let them choose their mics. Now, Nat, on the other hand, likes miking himself. So, do you have anything that you would like to add on that?
Yeah, it depends on the situation.
Yeah.
You can go from coffee house to main stage, you can go from one mic to 10 mics. And with percussion, you have to be careful, because if you get too many mics, you're going to get what is known as phasing, because mics have a certain pickup pattern and they pick up a certain way, and they'll get in the way of each other. But normally, you would close mic the congas. If you're using a big rig and you're in a club and everybody's mic, you would use a couple of close mics on the congas and a couple of overheads.
But as you can see, today, in this situation, we didn't need close mics on the congas, so just a couple overheads.
And sometimes, depending on the overheads, you can get away with a couple of overheads, and it'll pick up everything.
But if you're, you know, if you're really stuck and you want to know what to use, a 57 always works. Stick it with anything, and it's gonna pretty much sound fine. Okay, next question.
Okay, we've got Baldwin Rufino, who asks, what kind of heads do you prefer using?
Okay, so as I'm assuming that he's talking about on the conga drums, and I prefer natural skins, mule skin or calf skin. The natural skins have more tone and a little bit deeper and a mellower sound. And I usually use them most of the time now for when I'm doing sessions, so for recording. But in live situations, I want to use these Remo deeps, skin deeps. They're great. The best thing about them is that you tune them one time and you don't have to touch them again. I can tune these drums, put them in a case, and send them to Japan. And when I get there, they're pretty much still in tune. And also another thing with the synthetic heads is the weather doesn't affect them. If you're playing the natural skins and you do an outdoor gig, and until you have sound check in the afternoon when it's like 100 degrees and you're on stage and the sun is beating down, the drums are going to get higher because the natural skins will tighten in the sun. And then your gig gets until 8 o'clock at night, it's cooled off, the moon is out, everything is really nice and beautiful. You walk out on the stage to play and your drums that were tuned perfectly at sound check from doom, 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 now you walk and they go because the tuning just totally went away. So I prefer the natural skins for recording, but for live, it's pretty hard to beat the synthetic heads.
Okay, great. And Doug Gross was wondering, how often do you play live jams and gigs?
Live jams and hits?
Oh, gigs.
Yeah, live. Oh gosh. Okay, with 365 days of the year, okay, I would guess about 250 days a year I'm gigging.
That's impressive.
You know, let me expand on that. I just finished a 6-week tour with Diana Ross, and it was this year was her 50th year in the business, so it was like a big year for her. So we did a 6-week tour, and luckily for me, things have a way of lining up. So the day that her tour ended, the very next day, I started with Kenny G, and I went to China with Kenny G. And then the day that was over, I came back and did a couple hits here in L.A. And then I'll be here for about another 7 days, and I'm going to go back to China. And then as soon as I get back from China, the day after, I go back out with Diana Ross again. Then I go with a guitar player named Brian Hughes from Canada. So luckily, things just fall in place. I've been touring since 1978. And since then, I probably, the longest stretch that I've had off has probably been 3 months.
Wow.
Yeah. So I'm happy about it. You know, my wife's kind of cool with it, but you know. So.
No, we'll just do one more question for you. We've got plenty, but when did you start playing and who gave you lessons? That's from Doug G.
Okay, so as far as lessons go, they haven't stopped. You know, I'm always taking lessons. I'm getting a lesson here tonight from us, just playing with these guys. You learn from a lot of different places. I study congas, but I'm a musician, so I'm learning about music. I'm learning how these guys are hearing things, and so I learn from every situation that I'm in. Okay, more specifically, there's a gentleman from Cuba, his name is Changuito, and he gave me several lessons, and I learned a whole lot from him. Let's see, there's a Rolando Soto, took a couple lessons from him, he's also Cuban. So on each instrument, what I try to do is I try to go to that country and figure out why people play the way they do. The technique is kind of easy to learn because, you know, especially nowadays, there's books and videos. You can learn the technique, but why? Why this rhythm here and why that feeling there? And so to me, that's the important thing to try to learn. Okay, now when I started playing, like I said in my little rap, I had an uncle. I had an uncle who back in the 50s played with the Flamingos, old doo-wop band. And a time came when he had to go away for a little while. And during that time, I stayed at his house, and he had his congas were there. And so I was literally in there playing all the time, not knowing what I was doing. Okay, I got to tell you guys this story. I'm playing the drum. I figured out open tone. Okay, I got that. Bass tone. Figured that one out after a couple days. But I would go to the park, and I would watch these guys play, and I was watching Santana on TV, and it's like, I saw the guys doing this. It's like, man, how did they get that really high sound? You know, and they were doing, so I figured it must be like that. So I was playing. And it wasn't sounding quite right, so I started hitting harder. Okay, and harder and harder, and it was hurting, but I was like, okay, I don't care, I'm gonna learn how to do this. Every time I did this, this fingernail started digging into this finger, and it hurt so much that my hand just kind of turned around, and then that fingernail started digging into that finger, and then one day it was so much pain that my hand, I went to go do this, and my hand just went, and I went, I was in the basement. I was living in Philly. I went, Mom, I did a slap. And she said, get out of here before I slap you. What are you talking about? You know. But so those three basic sounds, I figured out how to do that on my own. But then from then on, I started getting together with other guys. Back then, there weren't any DVDs, and there weren't any videos back then. Sheesh. Okay. So, you know, so I had to ask around. You know, I had to try to find somebody who actually knew what they were doing. A lot of guys hit on the drum, okay, and that's cool, but you have to find somebody who plays a specific style, and they really know what they're doing for their style. So I finally found a guy in Philadelphia who did that, and then I just bought a whole bunch of records. My main influence is probably Santana. All the guys that played with Santana, all those guys were great, and actually that was like one of my dream bands to play in. And when I was young, I picked five groups and decided that I was going to play with those. That was going to like aspire to play in those bands. And luckily, I ended up playing with all the bands. And Santana was one of them. So that was like a big honor for me to go and play with those guys. And so, all those guys, of course, Mongo Santa Maria and Ray Barreto, but also Big Black, Paulinho da Costa. My favorite players right now are Giovanni, like Magic Hands, and Nenge Hernandez, and probably Luis Conte. So those are probably like my favorite players and my biggest influences. So I think that answered the question. Okay, so any other questions about what we've done so far? Tape, you weren't supposed to notice that. See, I have it in the same color. So okay, all right, so I wear tape on my hands. And most guys that play congas wear tape on their hands because when you're banging on these things, it's a physical instrument. And even when you play soft, if you play a whole lot, eventually your hands are going to start getting dry and your fingers are going to start to split. So a lot of people put tape on because their fingers are literally splitting and it hurts. Okay, so you put the tape on to try to keep it from splitting and to pad it a little bit so it doesn't hurt quite as much. Some guys put a lot of tape on and just wrap it really tight to like almost like deaden your hand so that, you know, it doesn't hurt as much. Me, on the other hand, the reason why I play with the tape on is because about 10 years ago, I was playing basketball, and I broke my hand playing basketball. Okay, but I'm, you know, macho guy, so I didn't think it was broken. I just thought I had just jammed it or something. And I actually had a clinic that night at a music store. And so that night I went and I'm playing my clinic, I'm doing the congas, and it was hurting so much that I kept changing my hand position. And then doing that, I hit the drum the wrong way, and I broke it on the other side. Okay, so that night we went to the hospital, and I'm sitting in the emergency room, and the nurse, it's packed, and the nurse comes out and goes, "What are you here for?" And I go, "Oh, I broke my hand, you know." She goes, "What are you doing?" I play the conga drum. She goes, "Well, you can't break your hand playing the bongos, you know." And so my macho kicked in. I was like, "Yeah, you know," and I left, and I actually went to Europe the next day, and I was gone for 3 weeks. And during that time, it kind of healed, and I was like playing like this, one hand with a stick, you know, because it was hurting so much. And then when I got back, it was still weird. So I went to the doctor, and that's when he told me.
He took the x-ray, he's like, "Well, you broke it in two places, and blah, blah, blah. He's like, we need to re-break it to set everything right." I was like, "I've got gigs coming up. That's not going to happen."
So I kept playing with it the way it was, but what started happening was this finger on this hand started going like this. And I could still play, but my tone wasn't the same as when it was here. And so I kept trying to figure out some way to get that finger to stay down. So I literally put the tape on just to hold my finger down.
Okay, and I've been to like every kind of specialist you could imagine, acupuncture and, you know, Reiki and everything. And all kinds of specialists and everything. And actually, the only guy who actually worked for me was a Reiki guy, you know. That's a whole other story. But when you see the Reiki, you also have to do, you have to see a chiropractor, and I'm just not into that. So it was either all of that or wear the tape. So I have the tape on. Okay. So now, any other questions? Okay, let's move on then. Okay, so our rhythmic journey began in Africa. Then it went across the Atlantic to the Caribbean, went up to North America. Now we're going to go south. Okay? So this clinic is mostly about drums, and we play the congas and the bongos and the djembe. And now we're going to play, this drum. So everywhere in the world, most places in the world, this drum is called a tambourine. But in Brazil, it's called a pandeiro, and it's a different language, Portuguese, but also the application of how you play this drum is different than a tambourine. Here I go. So, pandeiro. It's going to be loud for just a second, so I hope I don't spike it. More. Ashkenazi. Not you. Frente que quero passar, você samba e já é mado. É que eu quero é samba. Este samba que é misto de maracatu e a imitação é samba e preto veio. Samba de preto do mais que nada. Samba como esse tá legal. Você não vai querer que eu chegue no final. Oh. Que eu quero passar. Você samba e já é mado. É que eu quero é samba. Este rumba que é misto de maracatu, Luiz. É samba de preto velho, samba de preto do. Mas que nada, samba como você tá legal. Você não vai querer e quero chegar no final. Oh. Aria, yo, oba, 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 oh, aria, yo, Quinn, oba, 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 Quinn Johnson. Coach, check it. Hey, play. Ha ha ha!
I should probably tell you what this is. Okay, this drum, it's used in Brazil, but it originated in Africa, and in southern Africa, they used to cut down a tree, hollow it out, stretch a skin across the front of it, and attach a vine to the skin. Then it would get inside of the drum and pull on the vine, and it would produce a low growling sound, like, and kind of sounded like a lion. Actually, they used it for hunting purposes. Okay, then when the Africans went to Brazil for vacation, okay, they turned it into a musical instrument. So it's a hollow cylinder. It has a goat skin stretched across the front, and there's a bamboo stick tied directly into the middle of the skin. And then I use a wet rag, and when I rub on the stick, it's a friction drum, so it produces the sound. So it's kind of like when you have a drink from McDonald's and it's got the plastic lid with the straw. When you pull it down, the friction sounds like, oh, it's kind of like that. Okay, but it's a friction drum, but it's also a pressure drum. So when I'm rubbing on the stick, I have that pitch, but I can change the pitch by applying pressure to the front. So the harder I squeeze on the front, the higher the pitch goes. And then if I apply pressure to the stick also, which is dangerous because the stick can break. We won't talk about that, okay? All right. So, but it's the guica drum. Guica from Brazil. All right. Time. Ooh. We're going to skip, we're going to skip Milagre. Okay. And we're going to go straight to Batucada. To the bay.
Can you do one?
tambourine. Two, three, two. Mm-hmm.
carnival is a mandatory part. Like the government says, everybody has to park. Okay. So we have all these common tools, which are like community clubs where everybody goes to learn to sing and dance and play something. Everybody's got an issue. But the most important thing is everybody does.
Play. And if I could just get anybody just to play just maracas, okay? And it's also him. And if I could just get somebody else to, as a matter of fact, I think I might have enough self-worth to help me pass it up for everybody like to join in. Everything, pass it up. Yo, pass it up. Pass it up. So the samba is about everybody being involved, okay? Quit. You know the banda?
That's it. Everybody in! We need everybody.
Thank you.
So is this technically Thousand Oaks? Okay, Thousand Oaks Summer School, okay? Just here for you guys, all right? All right. Nat Scott. Louise Silvestri. Quinn Johnson. It's a pleasure being here with you guys. Thank you. Thank you for coming. I hope it was entertaining and fun for you guys. It was definitely fun for us. So thank you. All right.
Who was your favorite artist to ever play with?
All of them.
Yeah.
For real.
That's great.
Yeah. Right. Everybody I play with, I'm in the moment, and it's great. You know, one guy that I've been with for a long time, I've been playing with Kenny G for like 25 years, and that band goes through all kinds of changes, and you know, sometimes we get like really negative press, and you know, but for me it's always a challenge. You know, sometimes we're like a power ballad band, we used to be an R&B band, and then we're like the smooth jazz band, you know. You know, but I go with the flow, and whatever I'm playing, it's like the best thing that I've ever done.
We saw you with Diana Ross. That's
Groove City. It's the drummer, actually. Jared was supposed to be here. I guess he didn't make it tonight. But that's just, the band is so tight with Diana Ross that it's just, like I said, it's Groove City. So, and for me to play all those songs that I grew up singing to, it's very wonderful. And she's really cool. And it's just a great job. I've been on that band for like 24 years, you know. And then I was with Sergio Mendez for 10 years straight, but 30 years off and on. You know, and then in between that, I managed to find some time to do the Madonna and, you know, a lot of different rock bands and all kinds of jazz bands. And every one of them, at that time, I'm there 100%.
What about steel drums? You ever mess around with those?
I've messed around with, like, almost every percussion instrument. Actually, I have some pans at home, and they're difficult. So every once in a while, if I have to, like, you know, if I get a call and they say, okay, we only need you to play this simple melody line, it's going to be cool. It's like, okay, you know, as long as it's simple, you know. So, you know, it's like every one of these instruments, you can spend a lifetime just playing this, which a lot of guys do, and the same thing with congas. And so I kind of spread myself thin because I try to play mallets, I try to play the pans, I try to play vibes and marimbas, and I dabble in the drum set. And technically, the piano is also a percussion instrument. And so, you know, I got one at the house, and every once in a while, I sit there, and my kids are like, you know. But I try everything. I try to play all the percussion stuff that I can find.
So you studied Cuba, you played Brazil,
because
it's all around the world.
Mm-hmm.
What's you?
What's?
Where this is now.
Say what?
He said, what's you?
What's me?
Yeah. This is really
Yeah, it really, well, like I said in the beginning, one of the reasons why I work a lot is because I really do embrace everything that I get into, okay? So if it's Bata week, I'm a Santero, you know, I'm there. And if next week, you know, yeah, next week I'm a rock and roller, you know. You know, whatever it is, I go there 100%, and I'm that. And because of that, that's why I get calls, because people know that I'm going to adapt to their situation, and I'm going to bring it for their situation. So it's all me.
So. I have a boring technique question. I grew up listening to Santana as well. In fact, I was forced to see them for free before their first album, When the Lion Came Out. I used to sit in a tree, you know, watch Santana at Berkeley Community Park, you know?
Okay, yeah.
And these cats, all those dudes were just pounding the drum. Mm-hmm. So when I first started picking up congas, I started pounding too, right? And my hands were killing.
Right.
And then I heard an interview with Sheila E., and she said something about blood clots in the hands, mm-hmm. and you got to watch out for it. So mm-hmm. I was wondering, for those of us that are now inspired by y'all to go in to put in our 40 hours mm-hmm. next week, what, you know, can you give us some hand techniques? So about you don't really have to hit hard. I mean, not necessarily. The sound out
okay.
of the drums.
Sheila said to me once, because I was playing the macho game, hey Sheila, you know, look at my hand, you know, they're like rocks.
Yeah.
And she goes,
your hands might maybe like Ross, but you know, you can always just turn up the mic. Okay, so you don't have to hit hard, okay? Old school guys like me, I hit hard because the guys that I really watch like playing, Mongo Santa Maria, Ray Barreto, they hit like way too hard and their hands were like trash, okay? And I aspired to be that way. There was one summer, where the entire summer, I went to a construction site in the afternoon because the guys were working at night, and they had all these nice cinder blocks laying around. And I used to see how many cinder blocks I could break with my hands. Okay, so old school. You don't have to hit hard, but it's still a physical instrument. Okay, so work with your technique. Try to keep your fingers together. Try to keep them in good form, like a C shape when you're hitting. Don't play too high. Everything could be done right here. All of this is for show. It looks great. And if you do it, just know that you're doing it for show. Okay? Because that's what I do. You know, I bring my hand and I go all the way down and this far from the drum, I go, ah! Okay. So you don't have to hit wildly like that, okay? Try to hit always in the same place. Be definite about what you're playing. Know your tones. Like, play your open tone, play your bass tone, play your slap. Play the slap in the middle of the drum. A lot of guys will try to do a slap by hitting on the edge of the drum, doing this. Okay? That would be a rim shot on any other drum. So on the conga, it's also a rim shot. Okay? And it's cool, but it's not a slap. Okay? So when you hear anybody playing a rhythm pattern, it's going to be a slap. Okay? So that rim shot is just a variation that if you develop your technique and you can play all different sounds and then you do a solo doing rim shots, people are going to go, oh man, that's interesting. If you show them that you know how to do all the right stuff. Okay, but if you don't do the right stuff and you do that, they're going to go, oh man, I can't play. Okay, so just be definite in your tones, open, slap, bass. And there are a lot of good videos out of, you know, Giovanni's videos are great. Pancho Sanchez, who's one of my favorite players, has a completely different style than Giovanni. So Giovanni's stuff is like so fast that some of the stuff I can't catch. You know, I'm looking at it going, what did you do? You know. But Pancho's stuff is very clear. So Pancho's a good guy to try to emulate because it's easy to hear what he's doing. It's not easy to play, but it's easy to hear it. Okay, and you have to be able to hear it before you can play it. Okay? Cool.
Yes. Would it help?
You
mean to keep
your
hands like that? Would it help to tape them up?
No.
Nope.
Nope. Sorry.
Okay.
Do
what
they say,
not
as I do one of those things. Okay, yeah, mine happened because of
right.
That injury. Now, if you, after that happened to me, I started looking at every conga player, okay? And I started noticing that guys that have been playing 30 plus years, they play like this often. Okay, but I think with those guys, I think they end up with some kind of nerve damage from 30 years of playing. Mine, I got the nerve damage from breaking my hand twice in one day. Okay, so mine came all in one day. Most guys, it takes a long time for it to happen. But no tape. Only use the tape if your hands are splitting and if they just hurt so much that you just want to put the tape on so that it's almost like having a glove on. Okay, so it's just muscles it a little bit so it doesn't hurt so much. Okay. Anybody else? Okay, well, you guys have been a wonderful audience.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Awesome.
Thank you. Oh, yeah, let me have your instrument back. just put them over.
All right, everybody. Well, stick around for a little while, too, because Ron will be over doing a signing over in the other room. And we've got a lot of great deals today. So we've also got a few giveaways going on right now, too, which we'll get to in just a moment.
This. I've never seen him dance before at a show, and he was up on every song.
Wow.
Yeah. What a show.
Yeah, that was a good one to come to. That was really fun.
Shelby.
Now, 60 years of age.
Shelby, why don't you come up here? We're going to talk a little bit about a few of the deals that we've got going on right now. We've got Shelby showing some of this off here. So right here, say hello, Shelby. All right, tonight we've got LP Rumba Bongos, and these are coming with a wonderful, conga? Bongo bag, and some claves, which you were talking about tonight, so now everybody understands that. All right, and this is all at $95 tonight, so that's a pretty good deal, I think, for some really good congas. Now, the another one of the awesome deals we've got going on today, too, is the LP Rumba Cajon. Now, this is in natural, but we also have it in mocha color. And that is at $95 as well. We actually just got back up online. We lost our signal there, so everybody online was freaking out. So, because everybody gets excited about this giveaway that we're doing. And then, of course, when I was up here running my mouth, that's what happens. But thank you again. Thank you very much. Thank you for everybody coming. Thank you for everybody watching. So we did three products that we were giving away, all LP. One was one of the LP bongos that we showed you before. So that is going to Michelle Scott. So if Michelle Scott's here, nope, must be online. Call us now at 888-355-4377. You've got about, what do we say, 3 minutes? They've got 3 minutes to call, and if not, we're going to pick somebody else.
Question, how do you win?
How do you win? You enter online. So we had, how long was this going on for? A month, 2 months? A month or 2 months. So everybody enters in online, and then we announce all the winners right here, right now. So everybody here was also entered when they walked in. The next is the Americana Cajon, which is super cool. And that is going to Peter Trott. So you've got 2 minutes to call us, Peter Trott. And now the next is probably the big one, which is a 11-inch quinto and a 12-inch conga. And that is to Scott Puckett.
Oh, no! You
Where's that?
Yeah.
Oh! Congratulations! Excellent.
That was supposed to be Tim Hall, man.
Congratulations.
60 hours a week, baby.
There you go. There you go.
Thank you.
What's that? We'll announce the name one more time.
I can't believe
that. Kevin Osborne. No, that's me. Scott. Ready? Scott Puckett. All right. Congratulations. But stick around. I know you're going to go over here, and you're going to do some signings as well. Oh,
I have an announcement. For everybody that's here, I have a Latin percussion CD that I want to give to everybody that's here.
Oh, wonderful. That's awesome.
So don't leave. It's in the other room. I'll go grab it. Good.
All right, great.
All right.
Well, thank you very much, everybody.
Thank